Since leaving here, and in the midst of pandemic, it's been online and so on. So yeah, now based in London.
Right. And how much longer do you have?
So it's my penultimate year, it's just finished. So next year is my final year.
Excellent. Do you know where you're gonna go? Any ideas yet?
After I finish, hopefully apply to a master's somewhere to continue doing theology.
Excellent. All right, great. Thank you so much, Jonathan.
Thank you.
So Jonathan's gonna do our preach for today. So yes. So very exciting to have Jonathan back. Thank you so much. So we are going to start out with the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. So let's stand and sing and worship the Lord.
Passions they fail not. First reading today is taken from 2 Samuel chapter 7, beginning at verse 1, God's promise to David. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a palace of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." That night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place without a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men of the earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people shall not oppress them anymore, as they did at the beginning, and have done since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, who will come from your own body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with the rod of men, with floggings inflicted by men. But my love will never be taken away from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." Nathan reported to David all the words of this entire revelation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Matthew chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 1. A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Aminadab, Aminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife, Solomon the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, Abijah the father of Asa, Asa the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Jehoram, Jehoram the father of Uzziah, Uzziah the father of Jotham, Jotham the father of Ahaz, Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh, Manasseh, the father of Amon, Amon, the father of Josiah, and Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and his brothers, at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, Shealtiel, the father of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel, the father of Abiud, Abiud, the father of Eliakim, Eliakim, the father of Azor, Azor, the father of Zadok, Zadok, the father of Akim, Akim, the father of Eliud, Eliud, the father of Eleazar, Eleazar, the father of Mathan, Mathan, the father of Jacob, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Thus there were 14 generations in all, from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
If I'm convinced of anything about the Bible, it is that there is no set phrase, no sentence, paragraph, word or iota which is not important. So for that reason, when Stephen asked me to choose a passage to read from, I thought I would choose the one which is probably the most often skim-read or ignored throughout the New Testament. So I hope I didn't put you all through that for nothing. And I'm glad that Stephen's the one who read it. So there are two approaches which one can take when understanding a text, and we'll take both of them today as a means of understanding how this will speak to us. Firstly, we have to look at the context. So why is it important to begin the New Testament with the genealogy of Jesus? Secondly, we will be looking at how this will then spiritually speak to us, why it is important that we are told this now, as all of this is relevant to us still. So firstly, the context, which is why we have the Old Testament reading. We see that David, at that point king over Judah, said to God that he would build for him a house. And God said no. That is something which came later with his son Solomon, the temple was built then. Rather, God said to him that he would build for David a house. In other words, a household, the royal family of Judah. It's a family which God says he would bless and remain with throughout the generations. And yet when we read through the Old Testament, we see that it hasn't always gone swimmingly. We even see in the genealogy there are exiles, we know that there are famines, we know there are good kings and there are bad kings, despite the fact that God remains true to that family and to the people who they governed. So when we look through it, we see that there is King David, a good man, there is his son, there is exiles and famines. And when we get to even the exile in Babylon, we know that there are many systematic killings of the different kings of Judah, to the point that one of the final kings saw his children die before he had his own eyes plucked out, and that killed the line, as far as we were aware at the time. Which is why, when we then turn to the New Testament, the great surprise is the royal family somehow survived in the person of Joseph, the father of Christ, the foster father of Christ. The royal family went into exile. They were underground. They were hidden. The early church historians describe them as this is the era of the hidden royal family. They were hiding in small places until we get to the census, when they are all called to their homeland, which of course, where the homeland of the king's family are, is Bethlehem, where David was born. So when we get to that point of the nativity narrative, which I know we're still a few months away from Christmas, so view this as a time of expectation, we see the killing of the infants in Bethlehem. In other words, the family yet again faced another killing to try and kill off that royal family, because they were political rivals against kings like Herod, against people who had authority over Judah over the many hundreds of years. For example, the Babylonians, the Romans, the Greeks, and so on. So when we come to the Romans and we see Herod the Great, a man proclaimed by the pagans to be a king of the Jews, and no one from David's family, this is the time we see Herod and Joseph as rivals. Herod, a man who is proud, a man who takes his authority from the pagans and fights for it, and Joseph, a man who blood had deemed him to be king, and yet God had given a saw and a chisel and made a carpenter in the backwater of Nazareth. This is the two families now. So when we see in the New Testament this genealogy, it is not something just to be skimmed over. We see this is A, important, because it shows that Jesus is the person who all these prophecies have been pointing towards, someone from the line of David, a man who would inherit the throne of Judah. Somehow that family survived, and Jesus is the person for whom it is about. So the genealogy is of vital importance to establish the whole of the New Testament. It is about Christ. So first we have to establish the background to the text, as we see there. Then we have to establish some spiritual significance to this. Firstly, we can look at who the genealogy goes through. It doesn't go through Mary's line, despite the fact that Jesus gains his humanity from Mary. He is not a blood relative of Joseph. So one could conclude that Jesus is not in the line of David. However, an important theme throughout the scriptures is that of adoption. We know that Jesus was then adopted into the royal family as a full member. He is the adopted son of Joseph. Similarly, we are told that we are adopted into the divine royal family. We are called sons and we are called daughters of God. And so if all of these prophecies are true, and all of these prophecies point to someone who is a true king, that is Jesus, then we know that it is also true that when we are called adopted sons and daughters, it is not a second-class citizenship to being a blood relation. It is a full adoption, and we are fully the children of God. This truth is something which we must reflect upon. It is something which says a lot about who we are as people, within our nature, people who are the children of God. When I was praying about this as a truth, I thought that there would be two camps of people this could speak to. First camp of people, I'll address first, and then the second camp. First camp is those who are fully aware of who they are called to be as the children of God. People who are happy to say that we are now in the royal family, and yet use it as a means sometimes of arrogance. People who struggle with arrogance, pride, judgment, something we all struggle with at different points in our lives and for different reasons. So if we are to reflect on that, then we should take inspiration from Joseph, a man for whom he is born a king and yet is made a carpenter. Many people have reflected upon the fact that Joseph doesn't speak in the whole of the New Testament. All these prophecies point towards a king coming, and yet one of the primary descendants of King David, Joseph, doesn't say a word. Instead, he suffers in silence. However, we can glean from the text at least one word we are sure that he did say. We know from the ritual of circumcision that it is the father who names their child at the circumcision. We know this when reading about John the Baptist's circumcision. So we know that the one word that Joseph said, the humble king of Judah, was Jesus. In other words, the Lord saves. So if it is something you were struggling with, take heart from that. That you can remember that it is not the golden crown of which we are born to have as children of God, which we pick up now. Rather, it is the crown of thorns, the crown of humility, which we must take on. So take that as the first lesson for the first camp. The second camp of people are people perhaps you may doubt themselves. Doubt that God can use them because perhaps of their sins which they have committed before, or that God will use them, or that God has used them, or that when they see all of these wonderful people out there, which there are many in this church, who the God works through, who the Spirit works through and blesses, and when you look at those you feel like you pale in comparison, take heart from the fact that when you look at the genealogy, you will see a list of saints who are called the ancestors of the Christ. You see people who are prostitutes. You see kings who committed adultery. You see a whole kaleidoscope of sins laid before you. And these are the people who God has honoured as calling his family. And in the same way, we are honoured as being called his family. So those of you who struggle with doubting themselves and doubting what God can do through you, read that, read the genealogy, come to terms with who these people are, and you will find great hope in what you could also be, because it is who you are made to be. So as we, as the church, always have to do, we must always look forward to the second coming of Christ, when he shall return, when the beloved shall return to his church, and we will be called to go back to him. As we look to that, know that we will be called to those heavenly courtrooms, and the gates will be flung open to us, and we will be welcomed amongst the saints themselves. They shall know our name, we shall know their name. The people like St. Matthew, who wrote this gospel, Joseph, Mary, and all of the others who we may look up to, will know us by name and will tell us how wonderful we have been and how we shall be their sisters and their brothers. We shall not be welcomed as the lesser people in that household. We are to be welcomed as the full children of the King. We are welcomed home, not to a place to work for eternity. We are called home. So hopefully when you read through these texts, you will see that there is always light within them. They're not things simply to skim over, as is often the temptation with things like the genealogies. There is great hope within it. Because as we look forward to the second coming, and we look forward to the return of the beloved himself, our King, know that it says so much about who we are, and who we are going to be for eternity, the royal family of heaven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
As we remember understanding that we are children of God, that we are his daughters and his sons, let's sing this song that he is our good, good Father. Let's pray.
Who you are.
We thank you, Jesus, that you are here. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you care for us. And we thank you, God, that you are our Father. We thank you that you see us and that you know us. We thank you that we are adopted into your kingdom. That no matter what we do, no matter how far we run away or stray, you still call us your own. That you still want us. We praise you for that. Thank you for that peace and that knowledge. And Lord, we look towards this world, towards all that is happening, especially with the extreme weather, Lord, that's causing the different fires across the globe. And Lord, we ask that you would just rain down on those places. We look at, especially in California at the moment, God, would you just come? Lord, that you would come and you would take away those fires. Lord, that you would keep those people safe. Lord, that you would comfort those that have lost so many things. And you would protect those that are in danger. And God, we pray for the firefighters and those who are rescuing. God, give them the strength and give them the energy that they need. And God, we look towards our own NHS. God, we thank you for all the work that they do. We thank you for how they keep going in and day out. God, I pray, Lord, that you would give them the energy and the strength that they need. God, that you would give them the wisdom to continue. You would give them, the wisdom beyond their years. God, that you would bless them. God, we thank you that you see them and that you know them. And God, we know, a lot of us know a lot of different people that are in their care. And so, Lord, we pray that you would bless those people that are in the care of the NHS. God, we all have our own stories. So God, would you be in each and every single incident and each and every single person? And Lord, we pray for the family of Jeff. God, we thank you for the life of Jeff. And God, we pray for his family that is grieving right now, for Nancy, and for the kids, for Matt, for the grandchildren. God, would you just be with them? Would you be their comfort? And would you be their God? And I pray that you would help us as a church to gather around them, to love them. God, I thank you that you are the great comforter. God, I thank you that you are the one that comforts us when we are in need, that you are the one that upholds us. And God, I pray for those that are here today that are struggling, that are here today that just really need your comfort, that need to know that you are a good father, that need to know that they are your child. God, I pray that today that they would know that. That they would know that they are loved by you. That they would know today that they are cared for, that they are seen and that they are known. God, I pray for those people here today. That they would know your peace and that they would know your comfort. That they are not forgotten. And God, we come before you and name those that we know that are struggling. Those that we know that are hurting. Those that we know that are grieving. Those that we know that are sick. We name them before you right now. And I thank you that you are the great physician, that you are our healer, that you are our God, and that you love those so much more than we ever could. In Jesus' name, amen. Gathering our prayers and our praises into one, let us pray as our Savior has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. And so let's stand together as we do the peace. We are the body of Christ in the one spirit. We are all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's offer one another a sign of peace. And let's continue to worship him with our next song, There Is a Redeemer.
Jesus, cause of sorrow.
Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation, and your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and meet with you.
In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin.
On the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of our life.
At the end of supper, while taking a cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that his bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy.
Grant
us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Now, when you come to this table, we ask that you come and grab a wafer and then take it back with you to your seat, and then wait, and then I'll say the final prayer. If you forget to take it, you take it before that time, that's perfectly fine. It happens all the time, but we would like to just take it all together. So draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, eat in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your body and soul unto everlasting life. Take, and eat this in remembrance, that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen.
And we say together, Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gates of glory. May we, who share Christ's body, live his risen life. We, who drink his cup, bring life to others. We, who the Spirit lives, give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we'll stand to sing our next hymn, Jesus. Coffee next door, so please come on by.